In this video, we introduce formulas for the propagation of error, which gives us the most accurate way to compute the uncertainty in a quantity that's derived from multiple measurements. If you're already familiar with the significant digit rules for combining measurements, those are just a rough approximation of how to compute uncertainty, while the propagation of error formulas give us the real answer. So just to define the notation real quick, we're going to use x and y for the measured quantities. They have uncertainties of delta x and delta y. And then we use a z for the quantity that's derived by algebraically combining x and y. And then we use a delta z for the uncertainty in z. And there's three different cases we're going to look at. The addition and subtraction case, so if z is a sum or difference of x and y, then the uncertainty in z is given by something that looks a lot like the Pythagorean theorem. You take the square root of the sum of the squares of the uncertainties in those individual measured variables. The multiplication and division case, if z is proportional to a product or quotient of two measured quantities, then we switch to looking at the relative uncertainty. That's the uncertainty in z divided by z. In other words, that's like a percent uncertainty. And that, again, is equal to the square root of the sum of the squares, but this time it's the percent uncertainty in x and y that are being squared inside that square root. Finally, we look at the exponent formula. If z is proportional to a product of powers of x and y, then we simply modify the multiplication and division formula by putting those exponents inside the parentheses before we square those relative uncertainties of x and y. Finally, we're going to use a rounding convention to round our uncertainty to one significant digit, and then we're going to round the quantity z to that same decimal place as the uncertainty. Now that's a lot to digest, so we're going to clarify all this with three examples, one for each formula. In our first example, we're told that two masses are measured on scales that have different uncertainties. Our first mass ends up being 2.34 plus or minus 0.01 kilograms. Second is 0.75 plus or minus 0.02 kilograms. And we want the sum of the masses and the correct uncertainty on that sum. So I'll go ahead and use a z for the sum. And z is given by big M plus little m. And when I run the numbers, that comes out to 3.09 kilograms. So what about the uncertainty in z? That's given by the square root of the sum of the squares of the individual uncertainties. So the first one was 0.01, the second one was 0.02. When I run the numbers on this, I get 0.022 for the uncertainty in the sum of the two masses. And then we follow our rounding convention and round that to one significant digit, so it's 0.02. And finally, we express our final answer as 3.09 plus or minus 0.02 kilograms. And just as a double check, the significant digit in the uncertainty should be the same place value as the last stated place value in the quantity itself. In the next example, we're told that the speed of an object is measured as 2.52 plus 0.05 meters per second, and it moves in a straight line at that speed. In other words, we have a constant velocity, and that lasts for 0.58 plus or minus 0.02 seconds. We want the displacement of the object, including the correct uncertainty. So this time our combined quantity is a product, because to get the displacement, I need to multiply speed times time. And we plug the numbers into that, and we come out with a displacement of 1.4616, just keeping a lot of extra digits for now, and that's meters. Next, we look at the uncertainty, and this time, because it's a product, we have to state everything in terms of relative uncertainty. So I have delta d over d equal to the square root of the sum of the squares of the relative uncertainties here. So I'm going to take delta v, which was 0.05, and divide by v, which was 2.52. We square that, and in the second term, I have a 0.02 for the uncertainty in the time divided by the 0.58 for the value of the time. When I run the numbers on this, I get 0.0398. And then I have to do a little bit more in order to figure out the uncertainty on d itself. So in this formula, I'm going to multiply both sides by d, and that will isolate delta d. So I have delta d is equal to d multiplied by 0.0398. And this uncertainty comes out to 0.058 with units of meters. And we're going to round that again to one significant digit, so 0.06. Then in the final statement of our answer, d was 1.4616, but I'm going to round to the same decimal place as the uncertainty, so the hundredths place. And I get 1.46 plus or minus that uncertainty delta d, so plus or minus 0.06. And don't forget the units in the final answer. Finally, in our last example, we have a formula that involves exponents. So I've measured the diameter of a cylinder as d equals 1.55 plus or minus 0.02 inches, and then the height is measured as 5.30 plus or minus 0.02 inches. I want the volume of this cylinder, including the correct uncertainty. And there's kind of a geometry issue to work out before we get started on the uncertainty formulas. The volume of a cylinder is the area of the base multiplied by the height. And if the base is a circle, as it is in this case, that would be pi r squared. And this brings up a tricky issue. Our directly measured quantity was the diameter, not the radius. We really need to express the volume in terms of the directly measured quantities. So I have to plug in here that the radius is half the diameter. And when I square d over 2, it gives me a factor of 1/4. So I have 1/4 pi diameter squared times height. Now I can see that the volume is proportional to the diameter squared and the height to the first power, and I can apply our formula. So first we're going to find the volume V, and when I run the numbers on that, it comes out to almost exactly 10 cubic inches. I'll just keep several decimal places for now. Then I apply my uncertainty formula, and remember, because the diameter was squared, a factor of 2 is going to come out in front of this term, and then I put in the uncertainty in D divided by D itself. Square the result. The second term is the uncertainty in h divided by h, all squared. I'm going to add those up and square root the result. And when I run the numbers on that, I get 0.0261. Now again, to solve for the actual uncertainty in v, I need to multiply both sides of this by v itself to isolate delta v. So delta V is going to be V, which was basically 10.001, times 0.0261. And this gives me 0.261. And again, our convention here is to round uncertainties to one significant digit, so I'm going to call that 0.3. And then I'll round off my volume to the same decimal point as the one addressed in the uncertainty, in other words, the tenths place. So V is going to be 10.0. Plus or minus 0.3. Don't forget the units, that's cubic inches in this case. And we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.